Welcome to Better Science, where we help scientists cure all diseases sooner through better design. I'm Dr. Mike Morrison. I'm a research psychologist and lead UX designer at CurveNote, where my full-time job is to redesign scientific publishing. And CurveNote is also the sponsor of this video. So today we're going to be looking at redesigning peer review. When a scientist discovers new knowledge that could help cure a disease or something, it might take 2 years before that knowledge actually gets published and can start helping other scientists, because it has to be peer reviewed by one journal, usually rejected by that first journal, and then that same paper is peer-reviewed again by a second journal, and then accepted. For most of that 2 years, that new knowledge that can help people is just sitting on someone's desk. Peer review is the sacred process by which a scientific paper is read by 2 to 3 other scientists, and those reviewers decide whether this paper is science or not science. Peer review has this reputation for being like holy and mystical, but it's actually super mundane. So let's look at an actual peer review. First, the author submits the paper. Then usually several months go by. During this time, the paper is like waiting in the journal's queue and waiting to find reviewers who are qualified to review it. And finally, the sacred process happens, and it looks like this. Each reviewer is given a link to the paper and a text box, just a plain old big text form field. They can't like select a part of the paper and comment on it like you can do in Word. Which means a lot of peer reviews waste all this time having to say, like, in subsection 2 under your introduction paragraph, on the third paragraph, on the second line, you have an issue. And they can't use modern tools like bullet points and images to make their point. They only have plain text. So no matter how thoughtful a reviewer is about trying to structure their comments, it's still going to look like a giant rant. So in our sample review, reviewer number 1 wrote 200 or 300 words about everything they wanted different in the paper. And then reviewer number 2, somewhat stereotypically, wrote 1140 words about everything they wanted different in the paper. Now, cliches aside, like somebody who writes 1140 words trying to help you improve your science is really thoughtful and doing a great service for all of us. Like, that person cared. Anyway. And then the two reviewers send their very thoughtful feedback, which looks like walls of ranty text, to the editor, who takes 3 weeks to be kind of overloaded by all this, and then responds finally by adding a third wall of text, summarizing the other two giant walls of text and adding some stuff that they'd like to see. These three giant walls of ranty-looking text is what gets sent back to the author as feedback. And then 2 more months go by while the author tries to digest all of this and make the changes. What the author typically does is take all of these paragraphs and paragraphs of reviews and manually convert them one at a time into a concrete to-do list. So it's like, to make the editor happy, we have to do this and this and this. And to make reviewer 1 happy, we have to do this and this and this. And then to make reviewer 2 happy, we have to do this and 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 this. And then they kind of assign different parts of that to-do list to particular co-authors. And after they've updated their paper, they break all of those paragraphs up line by line and reply to each suggested change. Here's how we address this. Next line, here's how we address this one. And this like super mega wall of text with both reviews, the editor's summary, and the author's responses to each of those line by line is what gets sent back to the reviewers and the editor, who have to decide whether this paper is good now or whether they want to go through all of this all over again. If you look at this, we're still basically just mailing letters to each other, just like how peer review worked in the 18th century. The biggest waste of time in peer review isn't actually writing the review or reading the paper. I think it's these middle parts, the procrastination blocks, where the author's overloaded by all these ranty changes, or the editor's trying to consolidate these two giant reviewer rants into like sort of an editor's summary. Remember, scientists are still human beings with limited capacities. Really busy, overloaded human beings who've agreed to too many projects because of scientific FOMO. And just like any other human, the bigger the task they have to do gets, the higher the cognitive load, the more they're probably going to put it off and procrastinate. And the longer the work is going to take when they actually sit down to do it. But also, every millisecond of delay in this process is costing lives. We can't make the scientists work harder. They're already working harder than they really should have to. We have to speed this up through better design. I think we can shrink these gaps, reduce the procrastination, and speed up the peer review work itself just by helping reviewers and editors and authors structure their suggested changes a little bit more intuitively, so that everybody involved can read and understand the changes faster, even if they haven't read the paper in a while. First, just giving peer reviewers the tools to leave inline comments like in Word or Google Docs would shorten the length of all peer reviews without losing anything, because you're just eliminating all those sentences where they're like on line 7 in your introduction section in the second paragraph, blah, 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 blah. And it helps the author understand where precisely to make a change. And we should do this in a shared document, not by emailing Word files back and forth. Then we can make peer review tools more intuitive than Word or Google Docs by creating special tools for peer review. And if you actually go through and read a bunch of peer reviews, what you realize is that the things that peer reviewers suggest as changes to scientific articles kind of fall into predictable categories. Like here, 50% of this wall of text is just listing new references that this reviewer wants this author to incorporate. Like, I think the point you're making here could really benefit from incorporating the work of Jenkins, 2022. Sincerely, Jenkins. If we can give peer reviewers a dedicated tool for suggesting a reference, like add reference here, find the paper real quick, explain my reasons, and suggest. Then you save the reviewers the time of going to find the reference, and you can pull those suggested references out of the wall of text, making those references easier to process and leaving the remaining review text shorter and easier to process too. There are a bunch of other predictable types of changes like this. Part of the game of making peer review more efficient is creating more intuitive tools to suggest these common paper improvements. And if you can categorize and structure the reviewer's suggestions, then you can do something really, really magical for the author. Since the authors are just going to take all these paragraphs and convert them into a to-do list anyway, why not just format the peer review as an organized, sortable, shareable to-do list from the start? This consistent to-do list can summarize across reviewers and editors, so all the references you have to add can be in one place. And if two reviewers suggest the same change, that's one item. When each piece of feedback is categorized, we can let the authors sort them however they like. Personally, I'd want my peer review to-do list ordered from easy things to hard things. Start out with like, hey, good job with this stuff. Thanks, okay, I feel good. Here are some references to add. Okay, no problem, I'll send that to my grad student. Here are a couple sections we just want a little further clarity on. Okay, I can actually type that right now. I know the answers to these questions. And I think some additional analysis here would help. Okay, no problem, I'll send that to my stats genius. And one kind of big change. We kind of want you to rewrite your discussion section to cover these points. And it's like, all right, okay, I can plan for that. But it's not as bad considering I now don't have to worry about all these other things as much. And then when I make these changes, I can respond right in line on the to-do list, or at least tie my changes to the to-do item. And then the reviewers and the editors don't get back a super mega rant. They get back their own updated to-do list to go over. Better structuring the peer review changes opens up a lot of more intuitive interfaces. If you're an author and you want to see the to-do list of changes for your paper in the sidebar right beside your paper, that can be a view. You want to expand them out so that they float to the locations in the paper where they're referencing? No problem. These better tools and more organized peer review designs can provide the same amount of detail, the same amount of rigor, just less time wasted on being overloaded, and hopefully a more pleasant, enjoyable review experience for everybody. For sure, faster. If these saved scientists seconds, they'd be worth building. But I think they could reduce procrastination and process loss, which could save days or weeks per paper. These new peer review tools aren't just conceptual. We're actually building these at CurveNote. So if you'd like to implement things like this with your journal, get in touch.